All right, I'm going to call the meeting to order. Welcome all. I'm Tim Brous, and I'm Mayor Pro Tem tonight. The city of St. Louis Park has a long history of leading the way on environmental stewardship. With the council's consideration of a policy regulating polystyrene in the city is another example of that commitment. Also, in the St. Louis Park spirit, we are following a process in considering a policy that allows for ample education on the issue as well as public input before the council makes any type of decisions. Just as we did with consideration of a policy regulating single-use plastic bags, we're pleased tonight to have the opportunity to hear from a wide variety of people representing varied points of view regarding polystyrene, and for the council to ask questions of these experts. This learning experience will help the council and the city staff in shaping policy options for consideration this fall. For those of you in the audience who have an interest in this issue, thank you all for being here tonight. For those of you at home that have actually tuned in, thank you for being interested too. We hope you'll also find the panel interesting and informative. Actually, we're sure you will. Please note that tonight's session is not a public hearing, so we won't be taking comments or questions from the audience at this time. By September, the council will have some ideas about the shape of a polystyrene policy and what that might look like. And a public hearing will be held later in September to take any and all comments regarding any proposed policies. A similar process is proceeding for consideration of a policy regarding single-use plastic bags. A public hearing to take comments on the proposed policies is being planned for late August or early September on the plastic bag issue. Watch for more information on the city's website and on its social media sites. So at this time, I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome back our moderator for tonight's panel. Blois Olson is the principal and founder of Fluence Media, which specializes in media and communication strategy, data visualization and insights, content creation and distribution and marketing. Well, you do all that. And he's also a St. Louis Park resident who's generous enough to volunteer his time to moderate this panel. So please, Blois.
Thanks, Councilmember Brousson. Welcome back to those of you who were here before. Just a little intro to reemphasize what Councilmember Brousson said, is this is the first step in a process that will conclude in December. There will be at least two more public hearings about this. So if you're watching at home, there'll be plenty of time for input, and if you're here to offer your expertise, I'm sure this is just the first step in the process that the city has laid out. Just to clarify that I am here as a citizen tonight and a resident of St. Louis Park and a volunteer. We're going to kind of kick this off with a presentation from Dan Huff from the City of Minneapolis, who will give a background on the City of Minneapolis's process. So, Dan?
Good evening. Council members, thank you very much for inviting me here today. I am joined by some other staff from the City of Minneapolis. Cindy Weckworth is our supervisor with our health inspections. Kelly Kish is a coordinator of recycling for the city. And then our director of solid waste and recycling, David Herbholz. Thank you for inviting us to talk tonight and kind of share some of our experience as we have rolled out a similar ordinance in Minneapolis. I want to just kind of give you an overview of what I'll talk about, and I'm happy to take questions at any time. First of all, our history. Our first ordinance was actually passed back in 1989, and it was pretty wordy. It had a lot of aspirations that were perhaps not exactly something we could follow through with. Talked about recycling cords and bindings and strings and tapes and ribbons, and you know, unless you're one of these guys, there's not a whole lot of market for some of those materials such as ribbons or string. And the market, or that ordinance kind of failed, as you might imagine. It was just too cumbersome. It was updated in 1996, but there wasn't really an effective plan to how to implement that and work with our businesses to make sure that it was effective. So in 2014, one of our council members said, you know, I'd really like to revise this ordinance, wonder what's going on with it. We took a look and said, well, there are definitely some things that would need to be updated. Back when this was written in 1989, we have a very different world today. And so we started to revise it. Some of the things that we addressed in this, there was a real focus on banning polystyrene or expanded polystyrene, trademarked as styrofoam, and clarified some of the different things within the ordinance. It also talked about adding organics as compostable materials as an important part of an acceptable packaging. Some of the things were excluded from this ordinance. Cutlery was, straws, your plastic film that's less than 10 mils, so that might you see at a butcher shop, that would be excluded. It also excluded hospitals and nursing homes. We, once the ordinance was passed, really began to work with our operators. Dan McElroy here from the Minnesota Restaurant Association was very helpful in helping us reach out to his membership. And then we also worked with all of our other licensed food businesses within Minneapolis. The idea for this ordinance was to ensure compliance by education first before we moved into regulation. So we did a number of fact sheets. I believe you have a copy of our fact sheet that we developed in your packet. We translated this into a number of languages. This fact sheet was mailed to about 4,000 businesses, food-related businesses, through their business license renewal. Health inspectors also, as they visited food establishments, gave out this fact sheet and talked about the ordinance and to invite people to participate in the conversation. We worked through all of our different business associations. We had some cultural community forums. We have a very strong Somali community, a very strong Latino community, and we have health inspectors who are Latino and Somali, and they presented in either Spanish or Somali to specific groups on the ordinance. We had it on our website. We also hosted a packaging fair, a couple of packaging fairs, and these were really successful. What we did is we invited different distributors who provided products that would meet the ordinance to come and set up a booth, and then we invited all of our licensed establishments to come and learn directly from all the vendors and do a little price shopping and maybe try to pit people against each other from the different companies. But I think it was very effective to kind of get an idea of what the range of products are out there. We also sent out through email, newsletters, and 311 made sure that they had proper scripting so if people called, they could answer their questions. And then the media loved the story, and so they did all sorts of coverage on it, which helped us. Now, I know you're going to hear from Hennepin County here today. Hennepin County has been an amazing partner for us. They provide technical assistance, and they provide grants for businesses in Hennepin County. So a business can get up to a $10,000 grant, really easy grant form, and that can pay for, you know, signs or new bins, and then they can get up to a $50,000 grant that can help pay for, like, their first bit of new material, you know, the non-foam material. It helps to pay for training for staff, really looking at a waste audit, all sorts of exciting things that Hennepin County provides as a service to businesses in the county. We developed an implementation work group. I mentioned Dan McElroy and a number of the other folks that are in this room today. Actually, we all came together and started talking about this because there's always a lot of tails in any ordinance. So we started talking about, well, some things are not as easy as they seem. You have a paper cup. Consider it's probably compostable. But actually, most paper cups, like a coffee cup, are usually plastic-lined. Well, we wanted to make sure that we went to a different type of cup that would actually be compostable. But knowing that, that may take a little time, a little longer to source those materials. So for that particular product, we gave a couple of extra years. That also rolls up with the city providing curbside composting. Most coffee cups are to go. We want to make sure that residents are able to dispose properly of that cup. So we had very specific product discussions in that work group, and it was very helpful. And from there, we got a couple of different exemptions as we worked with our partners, both in the industry, the supply industry, as well as the food service industry. And we did a phased implementation. We didn't want to come in with a big hammer, beat people up for not having the correct packaging. So we really saw 2015, this year, as we're going to work with you to gain compliance. So a health inspector, the health inspectors are charged with enforcing this in Minneapolis, during their routine inspections of a food establishment, will write it in the report. You need to get proper containers, but not issuing citations or doing enforcement for this year, working with folks, providing technical assistance and guidance. Now, next year is when we'll really go back, the health inspector will go back, and at that point, if need be, citations would be issued. But what we're finding is actually very good compliance rates. Some people are still getting rid of their old stock. We didn't want them to just throw away old things and buy the new, but they're getting through that. There have been a couple of folks who got a product that was sold as green, but actually does not meet the ordinance. So we have tried to provide as clear guidance as we can. We even have on our website, and I believe you have a list there, of vendors that have presented to us at the city the specs of the material they sell, and if they meet the ordinance, we put them on our website as a vendor list. Now, we don't endorse any of them, but we have vetted them and can say that, yes, they provide materials that comply with the ordinance. And any vendor is open to submit that to us. So that's 2015, and then 2016, we're going to start really focusing on the waste collection piece of this, making sure that people have the proper bins. Because what's important about this ordinance, we're not just saying no polystyrene or making sure that you have recyclable and compostable materials. The food service business has to collect. They need a bin that will actually take the material appropriately and then dispose of it appropriately. Now, one of the lessons that we learned is we focused a lot on the businesses directly impacted by this ordinances, the businesses selling food. What we forgot about until later on were the operators of the buildings that many of these businesses are in. We have a number of large buildings in Minneapolis that have multiple tenants, and a lot of these buildings are old. They may not have room to add another waste stream. And in retrospect, we needed to reach out to our building owners and managers earlier on in the process. We did begin to work with them once they said, hey, we got to talk. So we have been working with them and making sure that we accommodate their needs as this ordinance is implemented as well. They're a very important part of it because they often, you know, manage the waste contracts, or at least have the docks where you have composting, recycling, and waste picked up. And then the other group is the haulers. We have a number of waste haulers in Hennepin County that, some of them specialize in municipal waste, some in commercial waste, but we needed to do a better job of outreaching to them as well to make sure that that part of the business, the downstream part of the business, was also part of the table. And then the I think one of the things that really has helped up is the just outreach and education. And knowing that as we go through this, we've made some mistakes, and we work with our operators, our businesses, our community to fix those. And the goal is that we have compliance. The goal is not to have a way to go punitive against businesses. So here's our website. That is similar to the fact sheet you have. And that's, I guess, an overview of how we've implemented this ordinance in Minneapolis. Happy to take any questions.
Thanks, Dan. Questions from council for Dan. Councilmember Singer?
Yes, I'm interested in what you had to say about making sure that the restaurateurs had proper disposal facilities. I can understand that if someone gets some food and eats it right there, they need a place to dispose of it. But I know that a lot of this is given to people who take the food away and go somewhere else to eat it. Are you really expecting people to make a trip back to dump the stuff in those receptacles?
Councilmember, that's an excellent question. And in fact, a local pizza joint that I like to go to, you know, they provided my pizza to go that I didn't eat in a compostable container, but I noticed they didn't collect compost at their store, but I was taking it home, so they don't really need to. What we're doing is that's another one of those issues that has come up as we have implemented this, said, oh, yeah, that's something we need to think about as well. So we're working with our restaurants to say, have at least in the back of the house a place where you can collect it if someone does throw the container out at your restaurant. But knowing that if it's a sit-down restaurant, you're going to have very few people wanting to, they're going to take it out.
Right.
Councilmember Mavity.
But aren't you then back to the situation that a lot of this is material that will not be collected by our curbside recyclers?
Councilmember, in Minneapolis, we are rolling out residential composting, and then we have all of our recycling. So we have worked closely with our MRFs. Don't really know what MRF stands for, but it's the recycling facilities, basically. Making sure that the material that we are requiring is actually usable by them, that there is a market for them.
Councilmember Mavity.
And just to follow up to that, then I have a separate question. Does the city itself, in public places where you would have trash cans, have additionally recycling containers and additionally organics containers?
It's another excellent question, Councilmember. And that's something we're working on. Our park board has now, with Minneapolis One Sort, they have rolled out the One Sort to all of the parks. In downtown, actually Dave Herbholtz and I are going to be meeting with the Downtown Improvement District to talk about what do they have downtown. There are the waste collection bins that take the various recyclables as well as municipal waste. One of the things that I think is important, and that's where we're engaging with Hennepin County, how do we ensure consistent messaging? We have a lot of the recycling symbol is pretty universal. The composting symbol or organics collection, not so much. Mm-hmm. So part of it is how do we work on messaging and how do we educate the consumer to make sure that they dispose of material correctly. So that is a work in progress.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And then my question, this might actually be more to our staff, I'm not sure. My recollection is that we recently, in the last year, two, 3 years, have switched over from doing health inspections in restaurants to Hennepin County, and that we now contract that out with Hennepin County. How might that, it was interesting as Mr. Huff was talking about the enforcement process, that was done through the health inspection department that really enforces this. And the question would be, in this scenario, if we did that approach, does the county either have the capacity or do we have the ability to ask the county to do that to enforce it in the same way since we're not doing it directly?
Yeah. Council Member Mavity, we've asked the county and they don't have the capacity, so we would have to research this a little bit further. I think that's, isn't that what you found out?
Yes, that's true. And they're willing to work with us to a point to identify maybe businesses that would be non-compliant, but they wouldn't be actually enforcing.
So for our city, if we chose to do that, we'd put that on the thinking and to-do list on how that would get done.
Thank you.
Councilmember Ross.
As I understand it, you've got a list of exemptions, certain items that aren't subject to this, but you've put in place a mechanism to annually review those? Correct? Okay, and I really like that feature because it gives your staff the ability to continually evolve this process. Has Minneapolis considered business composting for organics, especially restaurants?
Councilmember, in Minneapolis, businesses contract with their own hauler, so it's a private hauler that they contract with. Make sure I understand the question correctly. Are you asking if we're looking at requiring composting of all compostable materials?
Yes, at restaurants and other places like that that generate a tremendous amount of organic waste.
Councilmember, we have not looked at that right now. We do have a number of voluntary programs. Hennepin County has been very helpful in that. We have a kitchen to farm program where you have food waste is collected that goes to basically pigs for agricultural production. But they're all voluntary programs at this time.
Any other questions from council?
No, thank you very much for showing it.
One
coming here and sharing your expertise with us and
your
experiences.
You.
I just had one question, Dan, as you went, yeah. Councilmember Spano.
Sorry, let me just ask one quick question. Just what was the role of the business community in crafting any of this? Were they at the table for this? And if so, are there pieces of this that are particularly theirs, or what was the level of engagement there?
Councilmember, because the ordinance was an existing ordinance and we were doing more tweaking of it, we did work with Mr. McElroy and talked to our various businesses. I would say our formal engagement process was developed after the ordinance went into effect, the revised ordinance, as to how to implement it. We did hear from a number of businesses. And in fact, we had at our public hearing a number of businesses that were in support of the ordinance, saying that, we do this. I see this as something I do already. There was actually, for an ordinance that was in some ways pretty prescriptive of what someone could or could not sell, I was amazed at how quickly and easily it was adopted philosophically. I think folks felt that, we ought to get rid of polystyrene. I think most people feel like that's a pretty sensible thing to do.
Dan, just a couple questions just from background perspective. One is, as you went through the history of kind of waste stream management in Minneapolis, is this the first time one specific product had been called out to not be sold? Or had you done that with other products before?
When we were looking originally at phosphorus fertilizer for lawn, I think the city adopted a ban on phosphorus fertilizer just prior to the state enacting that ban. Obviously tobacco products. So there have been other specific exemptions.
Okay. And then you mentioned that hospitals and nursing homes were exempt. We obviously have a huge hospital in St. Louis Park. Can you talk about how that was decided and that process?
I think it was really just that there's not a lot of takeout from those places, and that it's mostly institutional dining, and it was a desire more of competing needs to say, we know that nursing homes and hospitals have a lot on their plate already, and, you know, let them manage their own operations.
All right. Thanks, Dan.
All right. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce Madalyn Cioci and Paul Kroening. Madalyn's from the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency, and Paul Kroening's with Hennepin County Environment and Energy.
Well, they look familiar.
I think they've done this before.
Good evening. Hi, everybody. Thanks for having me back this evening. I am Madalyn Cioci from the Pollution Control Agency, and I know that you have comments that I provided through Kayla, so I won't repeat myself entirely from the last time that I was here. As with plastic bags, the Pollution Control Agency does not have a stance on policies specific to polystyrene takeout containers. We support policies that will result in a net total waste generation reduction. We like policies that are going to have other environmental outcomes like reduced air pollution, reduced water pollution. Speaking purely from a waste perspective, the Metropolitan Solid Waste Policy Plan does have a goal of 6% reduction in total generation of waste. And so that counts all waste, whether it's disposed or recycled or composted. We're looking to shrink the overall waste pie by 6% by 2030. And then of that reduced pie, we want to see 60% of that recycled. So those are goals that we do have. You all clearly have a hard job because what is the right policy isn't always obvious. And I think the right policy depends entirely on the outcome that you want. So the question always seems to be why you want to do the change. You know, and I think being clear about why polystyrene would be a target would be really important. In the case of takeout containers, the conversation about substituting one disposable kind of container for another, I think, raises a lot of similar questions to the disposable bag question that you're wrestling with. For instance, if you're concerned about that total waste number, and you ban, we are talking about the foam, right? Expanded polystyrene, not the rigids, right? So if you ban the foam polystyrene, what takes its place? Probably something that's a little heavier, right? Paper is a little heavier, the compostables are heavier, PET is usually a heavier product. So if you ban the EPS, then you end up probably with a small uptick in the total waste generation. Right now, polystyrene is a small amount of our recycled plastics in the state. Polystyrene is less than 1% of the reported recycled plastics to the PCA. And that's all polystyrene, so the foam and the not foam. And it's about 1% of disposed waste in the state. And that, again, is all types of polystyrene that would show up in the waste stream. So that would be clamshells, that would be the foam and not foam. It would also include styrofoam packaging that, say, would come in large appliance boxes or that sort of thing. So 1% of the disposed waste. If you're concerned about total environmental footprint, I talked about that with the bags, looking at the whole life cycle. Polystyrene is typically a little lower footprint than most paper, compostable, or PET products. What I've seen, it's not a huge difference, but it tends to be a little bit lower footprint than those other materials. Again, I think it's counterintuitive, but it seems to be what some of the studies are showing. If you're concerned primarily with recycling rates, if that's your interest, and not necessarily the total waste or the footprint, then looking at a ban of expanded polystyrene, I think, makes sense. They currently are not easily recyclable. And then having compostables, you know, is a nice idea. If you can, they often have food left in them, if we're talking about takeout containers. If you have a way to collect the organics, I think there's an argument to be made that compostables make sense then. If your interest is in health impacts, I think that's an area where, different from plastic bags, polystyrene does have some issues. Styrene production is pretty toxic in production and can be hazardous for workers. There are occupational exposures to be considered. In fact, all plastics, when they're used for food, the science I'm looking at seems to show that there's some chemical out of those plastics that will leach, especially in fatty foods. So a little bit of styrene may come out, a little bit of phthalates will come out of other plastics. So all plastics tends to leach some sort of chemical. Ultimately, the waste and environmental impacts, I think, of choosing one type of takeout container over another are probably small. We're probably talking about small relative impacts compared to something like the asphalt shingles that come off of houses after a big hailstorm. Right? I mean, just that could really swamp the waste benefits that you would get looking at a polystyrene ban. So, you know, if you're thinking creatively about your waste policy options, starting to really promote, say, metal roofs or green roofs or that sort of thing, and speccing your roadways to include asphalt shingles could have really big benefits. So just, you know, some balancing thoughts about targeting waste policies, since I know it takes a lot of effort to implement any policy when you do it. And the complexity of the issues about the paper and compostable and the polystyrene, for me, shows that the root issue is really about using fossil fuel intensive goods for single products, for single use products. You know, that's just, I think, problematic. So if part of the goal of a policy were maximizing reuse and minimizing the disposables, I think that would be a terrific sort of consideration. I think it'd be really exciting to see what a progressive community could do by heavily promoting or subsidizing a reusable takeout food container sort of program. What do I mean by that? For example, the Department of Health, the Minnesota Department of Health food rules already allow you to take your uneaten food from a restaurant home in your own container. Now, I see people using reusable bags all the time. That's a shift that's been made since I've lived here in the Twin Cities. It was not common in 98. It's very common now. I see people using their reusable coffee cups. I know of exactly one person who reliably takes her own containers to take her leftovers home from a restaurant. So that's a social shift that's waiting to happen. But I think there's a lot of opportunity there. The city of Portland in Oregon has a GoBox reusable takeout food container program, and it's also starting in San Francisco, where restaurants offer reusable containers for takeout food, which are then returned to drop sites by the patrons, and then it's cleaned in a commercial facility and returned to the restaurants for use again. There was an effort like that to get a business like that off the ground here a couple of years ago, but it was a little before its time, since no one was yet considering a polystyrene ban in the Twin Cities at that time. So it just makes me wonder, what if a community promoted or subsidized a reusable takeout container program as a policy approach? I think there are a lot of exciting options to consider there. So thanks for the opportunity, and I'd be glad to answer questions.
Paul Kroening, I manage waste reduction and recycling programs for Hennepin County. The county has not taken a position on polystyrene. They've not considered regulation. Staff has not presented any options to our board, nor has any of our commissioners asked us to prepare anything and bring it to them for consideration either. Right now, our priority is primarily on increasing recycling and an increase in the availability of organics collection. Both the recycling focus is primarily on commercial, and increasing the collection of organics is both on residential and commercial. City of St. Louis Park, of course, being ahead of that curve because you already have curbside organics. Minneapolis is implementing it, and we'll be working with the rest of our cities in the next 3 to 5 years to hopefully get widespread curbside collection of organics. One of the questions was, does our agency see this as an issue? And as Madalyn had pointed out, the life cycle analysis of packaging is very, very complicated. and very, very hard to sort out as to whether is polystyrene a good, the best option, is a compostable food service item like Minneapolis required the best option. So for the most part, our analysis is it's not conclusive. Depending on who you listen to, and I'm sure some of the business representatives are going to speak later, will present some of the information they have on the life cycle analysis of their packaging. The one thing we've not seen, and one of the reasons we've not proceeded, is we really haven't seen any analysis from any of the political jurisdictions that have implemented this on the impacts. Has it really resulted in what they hoped? Successfully, has the polystyrene ban essentially been successful in reducing the environmental impact? If we could see more of that information from some of the jurisdictions, we probably would present some more information to our board and consider some options on that. Markets for polystyrene in Hennepin County are essentially non-existent, particularly for the food service polystyrene packaging. It is technically recyclable, but the fact of the matter, in the metro area, it's not being collected. None of our materials recovery facilities that accept the recyclables from businesses and residents are accepting polystyrene. Really, the only options for polystyrene recycling in the Twin Cities is some block and shape polystyrene packaging. There are a few businesses that have a lot of that in their packaging that are, they're recovering it themselves and are successfully marketing that. Food service polystyrene, I know of no collection programs whatsoever in the Twin Cities that exist right now. I say it's feasibly recyclable, but technically right now it's simply not being collected. Madalyn touched on this. Recent waste sorts in Hennepin County, we don't have a specific number for polystyrene, but we have done some waste sorts, and polystyrene is included in what we call our other plastics category. In Hennepin County, that's about 4% of the waste stream. And polystyrene is probably somewhere about half of that. So in Hennepin County, polystyrene represents somewhere around 1.5 to 2% of our waste stream. The one thing I will mention too before I conclude and take questions, the Minneapolis packaging ordinance has resulted in a big increase in interest in our business waste reduction and recycling grants. We've seen many, many businesses in Minneapolis approach us and put together successful grant proposals to get money from us to help come in compliance with what they need to do at the Minneapolis Packaging Ordinance. The one thing Dan said that's really a key, though, is actually most of those proposals have not come from the individual business, but they've come from the property management companies of the buildings they're in. So we've dealt a lot with the downtown, large downtown buildings through the property management companies who have tenants, especially on the Skyway level, food service tenants that need to come in compliance with the ordinance. So they've come to us to help them increase their recycling and implement organics because their tenants needed that service to be, come in compliance with the Minneapolis packaging ordinance. So with that, I will be quiet and happy to answer any questions.
Questions from council. Councilmember Singer.
I think this question is really for both of you. You were talking about the percentages that the polystyrene comprises of the total solid waste. And to me, it's somewhat the same issue as with plastic bags. They're very lightweight, but they take up a lot of space. And so I think when you, please correct me, but I'm assuming that the percentages you were giving were by weight. My question is, do you have some estimates on how much by volume these clamshells and other polystyrene products take?
Yeah, you are correct, and the percentages are by weight, not by volume. The second half of your question is no, I do not have an estimate of volume. It's kind of a misnomer because we measure solid waste and report our goals and our the amount we collect by weight, but yet I've never known a landfill that filled up because it got too heavy.
Right.
It closes because it gets too full.
That's one of my concerns, is all this stuff might be light, but it takes up a lot of space.
A lot of space. It's
voluminous. It's not decomposing.
Right. Correct.
And that's true. I mean, nothing that goes into a landfill, it's meant to hold things. It's not meant to decompose things, right? And so all of these disposable, single-use disposable items, I think you could make that argument for.
Other questions from council?
I'll just make a side comment that as we talk about these reusable containers, and some kind of program, it feels like in so many of these public policies, we're trying to get as smart as we were, 50, 100 years ago, right? So we're going back to light rail, we're going back to all these ways, and I recall back in the early 80s, I was in Russia, and you would walk around and you have these public water machines, like Coke machines, but they had glasses available, and you drink from them, and then you rinse them out on the rinser, and you put them on top for the next person. And that's how they reuse them. So hopefully we can be more sterile than that.
Councilmember Spano.
So one of the things that sort of struck me is both with the polystyrene discussion and the plastic bag discussion. If I remember correctly, in both instances, you, and I'm really talking about the MPCA, stated that you didn't have a strong opinion, or you didn't see necessarily, maybe to quote Phil Finkelstein, that the juice was worth the squeeze, right? So it strikes me that we would be remiss if you're sitting here not to ask you, if you have a goal of overall 6% reduction in waste, neither one of these things seem to fit within that. What are the specific strategies, I guess? You've talked about broad goals, but I'm curious, what are the specific strategies, and are there other things that we should be looking at?
No, that's a totally fair question, and I appreciate you posing it. And I didn't mean to suggest that this is, it's some small percentage of the waste stream. And so I think, looking at the waste stream, what we see is that food waste, compostable paper, that's 31% of the waste stream. That's a big chunk. And you guys, I know, are already, the City of St. Louis Park is really working hard on the organics programs, and that, I think, is a really tremendous effort. And I think going as far as you can with the food waste makes a tremendous amount of sense. Plus the methane gases that are avoided when it would end up in landfill by diverting it to composting, I think makes a lot of sense. So I don't mean to imply that it's not a worthy target. It's a smaller bang for the buck. Textiles are another waste stream that are growing. So they're probably up around 4 or 5% of the waste stream now. We have fashion that turns over much more quickly, and it ends up in the landfill. It's not collected curbside in most places. That would be another target that has a slightly larger percentage of the waste stream. So I'd suggest, making, I can provide the state waste composition study to provide more detail in that regard. But I also don't mean to undermine your very good efforts and intent to chip away at our waste and to get pieces out of it. And I appreciate that.
Yes,
just as a follow-up. Okay, so if 31% of our waste stream is food and compostable paper products, and as you said, we've checked that box with at least to a certain degree with the curbside composting. Mm-hmm. Now, we need to get more people, and if anybody's watching this, we need to get more people enrolled in that, because I think enrollment right now is about 12 or 13%. We're not getting the enrollment we'd like to see. But having said that, that policy's in place. You talked about textile, which is 4%. What's another big one, I guess, is my question.
I don't have the composition study in front of me, but I would remind you that the 6% reduction that we're looking at and that goal that I mentioned is that total reduction. So that's where we have to start looking at the source reduction of things, and why reuse is such an important element, because it will be by reusing things that we are able to get rid of some of the disposable things that are going into the waste stream. Because whether it's recyclable or compostable or it's polystyrene and going into the garbage, all of that is counted towards our total waste generation.
Another major portion of the waste stream that's missed is actually paper.
Yeah, that's true.
That could currently be collected in our recycling program. So even though we have curbside and we have commercial recycling programs, there's still, unfortunately, a lot of it being thrown away. Off the top of my head, I believe in Hennepin County, it's around 17-18% of the waste stream. It's the second largest category after the organics. So even though we have recycling programs, unfortunately, a lot of people are choosing not to use those programs as fast as we can. One of the things we're going to concentrate on, we're coming out with a new advertising program, which will start coming out here in the next couple of weeks, as we're calling it. It's our Recycle Everywhere campaign. And one of the things we'll be stressing is we do really good in recycling in the kitchen in our homes. We don't do so well recycling in other parts of the home. So we're going to stress recycling in the bathrooms and in the laundry rooms to try and get at a lot of the other paper items and the cartons and things like that that are appearing in high percentages in the waste stream. We're missing that. Like I say, we do good with what we generate in the kitchen. We don't do so good with what we generate elsewhere in the home and not in the home. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions from council? Just one quick observation. As you talked about percentages by weight, and as we've gone through this era of recycling the last, you know, few decades, what's the rate of public adoption once curbside's available, and what it means to containers and kind of that second bin in the kitchen? How quickly is adoption, and what has that meant for, you know, the percentage that gets eliminated from landfills?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think a good example of that is Minneapolis. Minneapolis is just now beginning to roll out their organics program, but they've been asking people to sign up for it over the course of, the last 6 months or so, really since spring. And Minneapolis already has 30% of their households signed up for organics collection. So the adoption in terms of at least subscribing to the service in Minneapolis' case has been pretty good. I think what we're going to see, though, is very similar to recycling. I started working recycling in 1988, and I really spent my first 6 or 7 years trying to roll out curbside recycling throughout Hennepin County. So I really think we're at a similar point right now to where we were with recycling in the late 80s and early 90s, and I really think it's going to take probably 5 to 7 years to see widespread adoption, and definitely of the organics collection. It's something new. It's a little bit more difficult than recycling, and it's going to take a while for people to catch on. Obviously, St. Louis Park, you've seen the numbers here. You're having a difficult time getting subscriptions here. That's very similar to other organics programs in Hennepin County and around the country as well.
Thanks. Any other questions from council? All right, we'll move on. Now I'd like to introduce Mike Levy, from the Plastics Foodservice Packaging Group, and Simon Hefty from Litin Paper Eco. Mr. Levy is Senior Director of the American Chemistry Council Plastics Foodservice Packaging Group, a national organization representing major producers of raw material suppliers of plastics food service and packaging products. Mr. Levy also serves as Senior Director for Life Cycle Issues for the Plastics Division of the ACC. Mr. Levy.
Yes, my name is Mike Levy, and as I mentioned, with the Plastics Food Service Packaging Group. Tonight, I hope to basically show you why polystyrene basically should be part of your program and not singled out. And I'll build, hopefully, on a lot of the questions that you just asked, both Madalyn and James and others. In the short time I have here, I want to thank Kayla. Provided you with some detailed information, lots of information. So. Tonight, my goal is to basically prepare you for the debate on pro or cons or polystyrene, and make believe I'm your debating professor, and you're going to be assigned to debate this, and you don't know what side you're going to get. So in 5 minutes, I'm going to load you guys up, and we'll go from there. But seriously, what we do support is, and before I forget, I'm joined by Dart Container. DART is a polystyrene foam manufacturer and one of the largest recyclers of foam. A lot of people say you can't recycle it. DART as a company has actually recycled 1.5 million pounds of that foam polystyrene since 1990. So we have a lot going on, and that's one of the messages that I have tonight. Simply put, instead of banning this product, you can recycle, but I want to go through why I don't even think you need to do that. Okay. We in the industry obviously support the use of the product, but a little bit about polystyrene, why it's used, and in particular foam. Foam's been around for 50 years, and frankly, it's been used because it's 98% air, and there's nothing else in food service that keeps hot food hot, like clamshells and cups, or cold food cold, for the use of that air. It's very inexpensive. It's 2 to 5 times less. So my point is all food service should be out there. If you want to build a compostable infrastructure and compost it, I think that makes sense. It's heavier and it costs a little bit more. If you want to build solid other materials, paper cups, that should be there too. But the reason polystyrene's out there is the fact that it insulates well, it's very inexpensive, and this whole issue of kind of reusables, the reason disposables are used in general is the public health and the sanitation, especially in nursing homes and hospitals, you know, whether it's paper, plastic, or whatever, it's that bacteria, you know, public health, that's the reason that we don't have reusables as much. In other countries, obviously, they have a higher, and I was told, I won't spend too much time, but the paper cup was actually invented because of on the trains, they used to have the common water things, and they had tuberculosis. So in the olden days, Dixie invented that first paper cup, and that began the beginning of disposables. So there's a public health message. Let me tell you a little bit about polystyrene per se. You heard in Minneapolis on the ordinance that you know, they kind of looked at all this information. But one of the things that struck us is the fact that many of the and I'll get into what cities have done. The question you asked is, what about the cities that have banned? And I'll talk a little bit about that and why it has and hasn't worked. But whenever we hear ban, the first question in our industry is, okay, well, if there's an environmental safety or health reason, that makes some sense. But I'm going to quickly go through and tell you why there isn't. For 50 years, the Food and Drug Administration has to approve all food additives. Polystyrene's been tested like anyone else. As Madalyn said, she said there's stuff that leaches out. There's stuff that leaches out of every food container. And that's what FDA does. They take the worst case, fatty, test it. In the case of polystyrene, the industry tested it. The average dietary intake of all the styrene that you and I are exposed to is 6.6 milligrams per person per day. Doesn't mean anything. But compare that to the 90,000 acceptable. There's a 10,000 safety factor. No one's ever gotten sick from polystyrene foam for using it, just like no one's got sick from paper cups. They're all approved and lined. Styrene is a chemical, but it's a liquid chemical. It shouldn't be confused with polystyrene. And about 3 or 4 years ago, in 2011, the National Toxicology Program said styrene ought to be considered part of the report on carcinogens. Dr. Birnbaum made that decision, and in the same report said, but don't confuse that with polystyrene. When it comes to polystyrene products and food service, the public should be at ease. The low exposures, there's not a problem. American Cancer Society, National Institute of Health have all said the same thing. So there isn't a health issue with food service. To get at the question that was asked of the Tube Pollution Board in Hennepin County, one of the reasons that many of the state agencies, for instance, the waste agencies, haven't taken a position is for what you heard tonight. From a waste disposal perspective, generally, polystyrene isn't a problem. It's a small amount of the waste stream. That EPA report that we were just talking about just came out, and we generate 254 million tons of trash a year. All of polystyrene, computers, insulation, food service, is a million. It's like less than a percent. In fact, all food service of every type, paper, compostables, plastics, less than a percent. So I think you asked the right question when you said, if you're going to increase your diversion, whether it's recycling or composting, what you should be looking at. Generally, it's not the 1%. And paper is about 30, 35%. Organics, yard waste, as was correctly said. So the non-plastic parts are like 50, 60%. And clearly, that's where the biggest opportunity is. And there's a lot of recycling and composting that could be done. The reason that we are against the bans in particular is that when I hear things about compostable and recyclable, that's different than composting. What you heard Minneapolis say is that eventually we're going to have an infrastructure to compost all the food service. But in the meantime, lids are exempt, nursing and hospitals are exempt, all of the food service and restaurants, of course, the meat and trays are, in grocery stores are exempt. And the reason they're exempt, part of it is the fact that they're not just an economic reason, but they do the job. Lids in particular reduce spills and coffee, and nothing seals better than that. So whether it's paper or plastic, I guess my point being is, if you're going to exempt these things, and I'll talk later about some of what other cities did, why have the ban in the first place? But the other thing too is it's a small contribution to litter. Now, as far as the life cycle goes, that's pretty, I'm glad I heard that brought up, because the life cycle is basically saying that we care about recycling, we care about end of life, but we also care about what it takes to make this stuff from, you know, whether it's growing trees and cutting them down or getting plastics from oil or gas. And when you compare that cradle to grave and you look at what it takes to make foam polystyrene compared to paperboard or compostables, I know Madalyn talked about there's some trade-off. Well, it's quite a big trade-off. And if you think about it, if something's made out of 98% air and 2% stuff, it's got to take less energy, less solid waste, way less when you transport it around. In the case of polystyrene foam, if you truly look at air, water, solid waste, how much is generated, whether you recycle, compost it, or it goes to the Hennepin County Covanta plant, polystyrene has a much lower footprint. And I can quote the numbers here. And, you know, in the case of solid waste, it's 2 to 5 times less. So when you talk about a source reduction or waste, just by using that product alone, you're reducing it, whether it's recycled. And I'll get into recycling in a minute. Now, as far as end of life goes, you don't have a polystyrene problem in Minneapolis because you're fortunate to have one of the 84 energy recovery facilities that basically provides a recycling recovery of a lot of the waste, the difficult to recycle waste after recycling, like your bottles and cans. The food service of all types goes to that Covanta Hennepin plant. You're generating not only steam and everything, but you're reducing landfills by 99%. You are already taking care of not just polystyrene, but all food service. Now, if you want to recycle it, you can, and we can get into that. But the fact that you already have an end-of-life position, an end-of-life opportunity, cities like Boston or Baltimore also have them, and they haven't passed bans because they already take care of the waste. Can polystyrene be recycled? The answer is yes, and the question is, if you want to do it here, we could basically help you do it. But there are lots of cities that have done polystyrene recycling. I mentioned DART as a company. Right here in the Midwest, Denver and Cedar Falls is doing it. The most recycling has mainly been done on the West Coast, 65 cities in California. In the case of polystyrene foam, you add a densifier to do it. It's just like if you built a compostable infrastructure to collect all the composted materials and then compost it. You can also do the same thing with polystyrene if you want to add it to the stream. But if you're thinking about an end-of-life disposal, like I said, Hennepin County already has a pretty good system. I've included some case studies by these material recovery facilities that Dan Huff. These are the folks that are actually recycling it, and these are the people that will tell you how they did it, what they overcame, how much material you need, and things like that. So it's definitely something that you can do. Now, meanwhile, what have other cities and states done about polystyrene foam? No state has ever restricted polystyrene foam, polystyrene food service of any kind. Now, why? For a lot of the reasons that I just said here, you know, about the waste disposal, also the impact on jobs, the impact on employment. In California alone, it would be like a $1.4 billion impact. So for a product that's FDA approved and frankly doesn't have any higher footprint than the others, the states haven't done that. But some of the cities have banned, and I thought a question that was asked was pretty interesting. You know, have they achieved what they said? The only city that we're aware of that actually did a study after a ban and stated that one of the main reasons that they banned polystyrene foam was to solve the litter problem. It's only 1.5% of litter, but it's visible. It's out there. So people think, well, that'll take care of it. San Francisco, in 2007, passed a ban on foam. And, you know, and the arguments were made that if you substitute one material for another and you don't get at the root causes of litter, behavior, keep America beautiful, really clean it up, and we do a lot of that, you're probably just going to have the same amount of litter but a different type. Well, San Francisco, a year later in 2008, the city of San Francisco, HDR, did a study. And literally it showed item by item that the polystyrene foam food service cups and plates and bowls that were replaced by the paper cups and plates, the actual amount of litter went up. It went up by the items. I think it was Madalyn that said, you're replacing an item that by something that weighs 2 to 3 to 4 times more. So it kind of makes common sense that that's going to be collected. And the question was a good one about weight and volume. In the case of foam, when these things are landfilled, they're generally kind of squished with big D8s and bulldozers. So your compaction and everything, it's pretty much the same volume and weight. I've seen studies both ways. So that, yes, that foam, you know, it's got to be compressed. But when you get into a landfill, if you've ever got behind any of these trucks and seen how it's done, it's compacted pretty good. The other interesting thing is, that was yesterday. Some of this, I heard mentioned Portland, Oregon. Portland, Oregon was one of the first cities back in 1989, I think, that passed a ban on foam for all the reasons that I kind of hear here. It's going to solve the litter problem. You can't recycle it. It's you know, we can do a better way. And the ban went through. They exempted the schools, the hospitals, and the reason they did it was the cost. They said it was going to cost too much for those institutions. But aside from that, 10 years later, they did a study on it, on every aspect. And there was an independent report done that said basically the ban was a failure on every mode, on recycling, on the fact that the alternative products generated more pollution, and frankly, they didn't get any more compostable operations out there. I know there's different things going on there, but our experience has been in a lot of cases, a lot of cities, particularly California coastal communities, that did pass some of these bans about 10 years ago on the idea of litter, haven't received, you know, haven't seen that dedication. So the thing I'll leave you with is, that was yesterday, but a month ago, the city of Honolulu in Hawaii has been looking at similar issues that you have here. And they just commissioned a major study on all food service and what the impact is there. And that report just came out. I think I provided it to you guys. But the parallels are pretty interesting. They, too, have what they call H-Power, which is like your Coventa plant. But more importantly, instead of looking at polystyrene foam, they looked at all food service. They looked at the litter impact, on the solid waste, on the cost, on the replacement, and everything else. And at the end of the day, they basically said they didn't need any special policy on any of the food service because of the amount of contribution, the fact that it went through H-Power, and they recognized that all of these different disposables have trade-offs. You know, if you want to use foam for hot stuff, if you want to use compostables for your, you know, organics, that they're all kind of there. So as you kind of evaluate this, I hope that you will really step back for a minute and say, okay, why are we really banning foam? Why do we want to ban foam? There's a lot of kind of things you hear out there, but if you start looking at, you know, environmental, safety, health, trade-offs, waste pollution, and then the biggest thing is the cost. I mean, the cost gets passed on. If these were, you know, products that had some kind of big, you know, arsenic type thing that you had to ban from a public health standpoint, but again, these products are used around the world. So what I would say is that just, you know, we would certainly want to work with you on this. And if you're interested in recycling, we've got a lot of expertise to help you do that. But again, our message is, if you're going to do a policy, make it around recycling versus a ban. Thank you.
Simon, do you want to go now or do you want to have questions and then you go and then take questions? It's up to you. We have enough time in the schedule. Yep, we are. Okay, questions sure. For Mr. Levy. Councilmember Mavity.
Yeah, so I noticed in your, and I just got the handout, so I haven't had time to go fully through it. No,
sure.
That's okay, I just didn't get ahead of time. But you have talked about the safety of polystyrene and some of these, and done some quotes from various.
Yeah, these are health agencies. These aren't
agencies.
My quotes.
So when I'm looking at some other information, it says that the EPA has reported that the polystyrene manufacturing process is the fifth largest creator of hazardous waste. I'm wondering if that, so I just, as some of these things are being picked out, I just want to make sure I'm understanding
sure.
sort of the full, and I don't know if you have that information as well, and you can certainly submit that later.
I can answer that.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah, that was a 1986 EPA report. And that report was later rescinded. It talked about basically the petrochemical production of polystyrene, and they were generating solvents. But when you make food service products in polystyrene, the only waste is the trim scrap, and that's not a hazardous waste.
And so can I ask about that as well? Because one of the things
sure.
as we look at this, in addition to I also want to understand a little bit more about when this degrades. I thought that this is one of the sources that we often see showing up in fish and different bodies that literally are consuming it because it gets to be so small it's not able to be cleaned out of the water systems and different kinds of things as it degrades, which is one question. But I also understand that there's sort of two hazardous toxins that make up polystyrene. One is a carcinogen, which is the styrene part of it, and the other sort of has a neurotoxin impact. And so as we were talking earlier about when food is reheated and there's different products that leach into food products, I want to understand sort of where this plays a role from your perspective in that.
Okay. When you say, okay, styrene and ethylbenzene are the two chemicals that make polystyrene. Mm-hmm. When you put them together in a polymer, in a plastic, solid plastic, the amount of those chemicals are infinitesimal. That's then where the FDA comes in. Those quotes that I mentioned to you was actually measuring how much styrene it goes into that product. Mm-hmm. Styrene leaching into polystyrene is natural. That's no different than some sulfur compound leaching into a paper product. So it's accepted by the FDA. You have to show that you're under the safe levels of exposure. So it's natural if you're going to go into heating a product, in whether it's in a microwave or something else, and driving out some of that product. In this case, styrene is actually permitted to leach out at a certain level. And that's why the FDA, they won't approve it if it's over a certain amount. So, but the key is that you're in the parts per billion when you make a polystyrene product. It's not styrene, the liquid that's used to, make other products. As far as the degradability issue, that's a good one. Polystyrene is like most plastics, and they don't degrade. And in fact, there's arguments about whether degrading is good or bad. I mean, if something is going to degrade, it's going to rot, and it's going to generate, methane and things like that. So there's a school of thought that stuff in landfills should not degrade because you don't want it contributing. As far as the ingestion goes, I've seen some studies that, unfortunately, litter items eventually find their way into the ocean. And polystyrene does break down into little pieces. Those pieces have been ingested by sea life, just like pieces of other things have been ingested. To our knowledge, it hasn't been a health hazard. It's a nuisance hazard because it goes through a system, but it does break down into pieces if, it's left for a long time. But it's not of a hazardous nature, just like if you burn it, it's not, it breaks down to carbon and hydrogen. So that's kind of where that is.
And just a quick follow-up, I wonder if I could ask staff if there's any research done on our lakes, because you mentioned oceans, and I know I hear a lot about that as well, but on our lakes as well for Lake Superior or even any of the other water?
There's some new studies for marine pollution.
Just 1 minute, if you would. Just want to make sure that staff gets that. So it'd be helpful to get that information back as a follow-up to see if we're seeing anything in Minnesota. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm glad you brought it up. We've made a global commitment working with NOAA and Ocean Conservancy, and all of the new studies that are coming out, including the Great Lakes Commission right now, and they're studying all of plastics. There's quite a bit of involvement in that. So we're working on programs to reduce the amount going in, and I'd be happy to, if you're interested in that subject, we actually have a full-time marine debris person.
We need to keep going. Questions.
Sure. Just okay.
Questions. Councilman Sanger.
You have been stressing that rather than banning, that we should be focusing on recycling of polystyrene, and yet up until today what we've been told pretty consistently is that the reason why there is no recycling of polystyrene products here is because there's no market for it. And so perhaps you could enlighten us as to if there was to be a polystyrene recycling program of some sort started here, what would happen to that? Is there, in fact, a good, viable market that would make such a process worthwhile?
Well, going back to Minneapolis, when we sat around the table, we offered the same thing, that if you wanted to bring some of our experts in to help you with markets, there are markets. There are markets for recycling. Recycling is like anything else. If you collect enough of it and there's a market for it and you can reprocess it. Now, I'd kind of qualify that by saying, if you're looking at recycling from an end-of-life perspective, Hennepin County already takes care of that. But if you want to say, okay, instead of food service already being recovered, we're going to kind of pick it apart. What I would say is paper recycling, compostable, and polystyrene recycling could all be done. So it's a matter of if you want to add a densifier to a program, in certain parts. The material is recycled into picture frames and into CDs, and there's end markets for it. it's like anything else. It's getting enough of the material to recycle. And remember we talked about where you're focusing your on your 1%? I mean, we could get a fraction of that 1% for foam and recycle it. It may not make a big dent in your overall 6% number, but it's certainly going to help.
Other questions from council? Councilmember Bross.
One of my concerns with polystyrene food packaging containers is the litter issue. I mean, can you give me an estimate of how long it's going to take to break down if it's just exposed to the elements on the roadside?
It doesn't break down. Just like basically your paperboard items that are littered, I've seen studies on that, and it's going to end up in the waterways. It's not going to break down within a certain amount. Polystyrene is going to stay solid, and you know, and basically our experience has been all of the programs that we work with neighborhoods and Keep America Beautiful is they collect it up with all their other litter, like cans and bottles and everything else. The idea that litter magically disappears if it's made from like paper, especially food service, is kind of a misnomer. It's coated with plastics. It's not going to magically disappear, so it's not going to break down. It does need to be collected, and we strongly feel that polystyrene, like any plastic, doesn't belong in the litter stream. And we've been teaming up with Keep America Beautiful and then the affiliates to get at programs, different neighborhoods, to try to get at the root source of littering, which is usually, you know what they all are. I mean, it's a constant project of education and enforcing laws and things like that. But no, it's not going to break down. And as I said before, frankly, if you think about it, do you want stuff breaking down and then having the breakdown products of that going into the ground, water, and into the litter stream, right? Into the water.
Other questions from council? Thank you, Mike. Simon Hefty from Litin Paper, Litin Eco. Simon is the manager for Litin Eco, a division of Litin Paper, which specializes in the sales of compostable food packaging products. Litin Eco has several state contacts for compostable products, including the state of Minnesota. Mr. Hefty.
I'd like to thank the City of St. Louis Park for having me today. I'm truly honored and excited to be here for this debate. I'd like to remind council that I'm not here advocating any product. I was asked to be here to talk about alternatives to number six plastic polystyrene. So that's what I'd like to speak on today. One of the quick things, just because I've been hearing a bunch, so I throw in a couple of things that maybe I didn't have here real quick. Early adapters, we were talking about consumers at home, places throughout the country that have been doing early adoption of organic recycling. Big one that I'd like to bring up is our pro sports arenas. Understand that the pro sports arenas in the United States generate a ton of organics, a ton of food waste, a ton of recyclable plastic materials that they use to serve on, and a lot of pro sports arenas are starting to build their own green councils within those sporting groups. The Twins are a great example of that. The Wild have been doing it for multiple years at the River Center. They have some massive numbers about the amount of organic recycling and compostables that they've been able to generate in the last 4 or 5 years. The numbers are huge, so I highly recommend maybe talking to them about what they're able, you know, what they've been doing by education and collection. The main types of packaging that you're considering banning, we've talked about, is number six foam containers, bowls, plates, and cups. My question, after hearing what folks have talked about, I'm uncertain on, are you also banning number six clear plastics and any other polystyrene plastic in general? Like Minneapolis did, they said in their ordinance that they were going to disband of all of it.
Who would like to answer that?
I can answer that, I think, on behalf of the council, which is that we have not decided to do any action at this point, and actually part of what we're asking for is the information to help us evaluate what those choices and options and benefits and costs would be.
Okay, I just want to make sure that this still would make sense if I spoke about the other number sixes that are out there. So the number sixes that you'll find a majority of in our food service is what we mentioned with the foam containers, bowls, plates, and cups. Number six is also relevant in clear clamshells that are out there for food service. A lot of salads are distributed through that, as well as polystyrene is used in to-go hot cup lids. Starbucks and Caribou all use number six plastic for their lids, and so those are the types of number sixes that are out there. Remember that all manufacturers use different diameters and molds for their products. So that if you ban a specific material, the business or whatever it is has to find a new manufacturer that would be needed for cups and lids or other products that need to go together. So the point is there is that not all coffee lids are universal. So if you ban a coffee lid but you don't ban the paper poly lined cup, those don't always go together. You can't just find a lid sometimes to make that work. Alternatives are the most important thing to a ban. What can I use as a business owner if I cannot use number six plastic? Compostable food packaging is luckily now the answer, and I believe will continue to be for a long time. Products made from sustainable, renewable sources that can be turned directly back into the soil that was used to grow that raw material in the first place, which I think is an amazing thing. For clamshells, the direct replacement for foam clamshells and plates and cups is bagasse. And you can see from my slide what bagasse is. It's the second bullet there. Cups are replaced with PLA clear cups or paper/PLA lined cups. We've been talking a lot about poly lined cups. There is a paper cup that exists that has a PLA lining that has been used in this Twin Cities area for years that you can use for coffee or any kind of other kind of hot liquid and is 100% compostable and BPI certified. And I can answer what BPI certified if you're not aware of what that is. And then for CPLA lids, here's again alternative to the number six plastics that we talked about for clear containers. There are PLA clear hinge containers that exist. PLA again is polylactic acid. It's an NGO product that is grown in Nebraska, and it's sugar that is used to produce these materials, and they're 100% compostable. The last item we talked about earlier is the is a number six polystyrene coffee cup lid. There are CPLA coffee cup lids out there, the compostable. So when you think of these alternative products, the way that they're made, there are better options and how the number six plastics are made. You should know that a lot of manufacturers offset their carbon footprint by 100% to get these products to market. Being BPI certified, these products' end life is organic soil. Being that you are a community with organic curbside pickup, unfortunately only 13% at this time, I just heard, you have the best advantage to recycle these alternative products effectively. There will always be a market for organic soil. Minneapolis uses much of its organic soil the organic soil that is developed in southern Minnesota by the composting, commercial composting sites, they use a lot of their soil to grow trees and plants along their streets. So they have an abundance of the soil, and they actually, I heard that when we were doing the Minneapolis ban, that they have a higher need than what is being generated. So we actually have a larger need for the organic soil. You must have some sort of container, cup, and lid to run any to-go program. Using compostable products reduces waste in huge numbers. The effectiveness of the alternative products in your community is largely impacted by your ability to curbside organic recycle. In Minneapolis, there have been exemptions on coffee lids and cups that Mr. Huff spoke to. The only reason for this, my understanding, was the current inability to have consumers in Minneapolis putting them curbside. You know, you take the cup home, what are you going to do with it? You know, Councilman Sanger asked about that. You know, if you have organic recycling, you can put all these alternative products in that along with your organic waste and paper. Let's see. These cups and lids have been sold in premium arenas across the country for years and are used in coffee shops around the Twin Cities for the last 5 years. We have moved almost 1 million coffee lids in the last 12 months. These products work. They accomplish what their purpose and function are in an effective profit-making ability for these businesses that use them on a daily basis. So right here, I pulled this right from your website. Unfortunately, it doesn't say the percentage. I thought this was a big statement. Again, your community, unlike others in the area, you have organic recycling as an option for your consumer, and the alternative product with using compostable products can be put right into that and be recycled, be turned back into organic dirt, and that organic dirt goes to a lot of places. It ends up at Councilman Brawson's house that he puts in his lawn or in his garden. So it comes full circle. I'd like to say in closing that for the last centuries, our world has continued to develop better products for our civilization. Plastics have their place now and will continue to have a purpose for years to come. But more and more compostable products will be made, and these products will continue to move the evolution of packaging forward. In that instance, I brought today the first of its kind. This product, as you can see, is a baseball helmet. This is used at the Twins Stadium. It's been used in stadiums across the country in all different forms. It's mainly made out of plastic. This is made by a Minnesota manufacturer, and this is 100% BPI certified compostable, first of its kind. Thank you.
Questions from council.
Sure, I have a couple. Well, thank you for your presentation. It's, I think, helpful to understand what some of the alternative choices are. Yeah, should a ban go into place, and certainly in Minneapolis and other places. I don't know if this is directly for you. So, love the array of options. I don't know if this is for you. It might be for our previous person. It's come up a couple times, which is that sports facilities, health, you know, hospitals and such have been exempt from some of these.
Just the hospitals.
Just the hospitals, not the sports facilities.
No. Correct. We have multiple sports facilities here that do organic recycling.
They do it. Are they so that when the ban goes in place in Minneapolis on polystyrene, that has included the sports stadium as well?
Was the Twin Stadium included on your ban? Yes, it was.
They've been working to move that way to begin with.
They were doing it anyway.
It's an initiative of most major league sports.
Because of the amount of waste it generates. The amount of waste it generates is massive.
I don't spend a lot of time at those sports stadiums. Well, I'm glad that others know that.
Councilmember Ramsey, I'm here to help.
More than I do.
I'm worried about the sugar leaching into your salad is what I'm worried about.
Yeah, well, that too. I'm worried about lots of sugar leaching in. So, but I want to better understand the hospital issue and why that's been exempt, and why that's been exempt not just locally, but in other places. I think that would be... it feels like a big component, and certainly for St. Louis Park, with Park Methodist here, it would have a pretty significant impact. And I'm not understanding that entirely about how that has come into play. So I don't know if that's Mr. Huff or Mr. Levy or who that might be. But
I would say it's Mr. Huff. And
is that okay?
Right up here.
Right up here is fine.
Thank you.
Councilmember, part of the question, too, is... who regulates hospitals? Hospitals are traditionally under the Department of Human Services at the state, so the city does not have jurisdiction over in-room service for the hospitals and nursing homes, so it's primarily a jurisdictional issue.
And that is true for the food services on site?
The cafeteria, say at HCMC, we license and inspect. We do not license what goes to the room service. That's under DHS.
And so what you license at the cafeteria, is that covered under the ban?
We, as a city, chose to exempt that because the more you have two different jurisdictional authorities regulating two different parts of the hospital operations that are both providing food to people. So in order to not muddy the waters between DHS, what the state does, and what the city does, we do have private vendors at hospitals that have a private licensee. They do comply with, so if you have a caribou, for example, at a hospital, they would comply with the ordinance.
And then I have one follow-up, I think, then.
For Mr. Hefty?
For Mr. Hefty, thank you. Thank you for that. In terms of the capacity in the industry today to for replacement, is there a ramp-up period? Is there capacity right now? I mean, how quickly would it take for the market to respond to an increased demand for these kinds of products if hospitals and other communities and everyone suddenly banned it all? Do we actually have replacements available?
Yeah, I believe with the amount of manufacturers of compostable products and the continuation of other folks getting into them, I do believe that we have plenty of product to currently, if you said tomorrow that we need to make a change, there's a lot of product moving around this country, okay. Without a doubt, yeah.
Thank you.
Questions from council members? Mr. Hefty? I have one. How have you seen the various prices and price volatility of your business impacted by commodity prices?
On the compostable side?
Yeah.
Okay, so ask, what do you mean?
So, for instance, some of the early alternatives were made out of corn. That is a volatile commodity price that impacted those alternatives, which made it price available at one point and then price prohibitive for businesses just a couple months later.
Okay. When Cargill developed PLA, as far as my understanding, it's always been a sugar extraction. It's
no.
They use what? Kernels?
Corn.
Corn starch. They started with corn starch.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I wasn't in that early.
Okay.
Much of it is still corn starch.
Yeah.
Everything that we've done is PLA. It's all sugar based. All the clear containers that we're using are sugar based.
Okay.
The other products are on the bagasse side. That's the wheat starches and wheat and grasses.
Okay.
The PLA continues to be an expensive raw material, but it is grown by NGO in Nebraska for its purpose. We're not really playing the game of it's going to ethanol. It's going to you and I to eat. It's its own self-sustaining entity.
Okay. Right. Yes, Councilmember Sanger.
Of the typical kinds of foods and beverages that are carried out by people from restaurants or deli counters or whatever, are there any kinds of food products that for which there are no alternative appropriate packaging available?
Pretty broad question.
That's yeah. It is my job to go to restaurants and other places and replace their products that they're currently using upon request to compostable products. I would say 99% we've been able to make a change on. It might not look the same. It functions the same, but it doesn't maybe look exactly the same. With paper PLA line cup, if I put two paper cups in front of you, you couldn't tell the difference.
Yeah, I'm not really concerned whether it looks exactly the same.
Sure.
I'm saying
just alternatives.
Functionally,
right.
Is there a functional equivalent?
Absolutely. Dan, would you like to say something?
Well, Dan's up next, so we'll
all right, so he can
keep it on track.
Okay.
We've been very successful at changing most products over. I'm trying to think of an instance real quick that I haven't done. I get plastic bags, like single serve plastic bags. There's not a great manufacturing for that quite yet. Like a sandwich baggie, you know, like a sandwich bag. It exists. It's very expensive, but the evolution continues to grow as a manufacturer sees an opportunity to replace a product. They've come out with it. One of the manufacturers I work with, they came up with 8 new products as of January 1st of 2015. That was on top of a 6-page catalog that they already develop, that they already manufacture.
Any other questions from council? Yes.
Yeah, quick. And I apologize if this information is handy and staff may have it, or you may. Do you know in how many, how large is this market right now? How many municipalities, states, other jurisdictions? have bans in place in terms of sort of opening up this market demand?
The highest that I've seen is on the West Coast, but I don't know of any other specifics. The West Coast is where I've seen the most bans and where they moved the.
And does staff have anything to add to that?
I mean, we know in the state of Minnesota that the city of Minneapolis has the environmental packaging ordinance, and it's the only one in the state. We're aware of several other larger municipalities that have bans on polystyrene, but we have not done in-depth research on
that
percentages.
Any other questions from council for Ms. Hefty? Thank you.
Thank you.
Transition here to business organizations, and we'll start out with Deb McMillan from the TwinWest Chamber of Commerce. Ms. McMillan is Director of Public Affairs and has been with TwinWest in this capacity since July 2013. Joining her are Dan McElroy, the Executive Vice President of the Minnesota Restaurant Association, and he also leads a coalition called Hospitality Minnesota. And joining them is Tim Wilkin, who's involved in public policy in various positions, and he's the President of the Minnesota Beverage Association.
Good evening, Council members. I'm Deb McMillan. I'm with the TwinWest Chamber of Commerce. I'm the Director of Government Affairs. And I have none of the same smarts that any of these other people do regarding all this packaging and all these technical things. But I do want to talk about geography a little bit. So you're going to hear a lot of familiar things from the plastic bag event. So thanks for inviting us to take part. And the City of St. Louis Park has been a leader in adopting policies and programs to encourage and incentivize recycling, such as the organics curbside recycling. Evidenced by robust programs and a website to educate, encourage, and support sustainability efforts without punitive bans. To that end, we encourage you to consider carefully what you would like to accomplish through your environmental and sustainability programs and devise a system to ensure that you are meeting those goals in a way that can be measured and won't negatively impact business development and business retention here in St. Louis Park. It will come as no surprise that the business community has deep concerns about adopting a policy that bans certain products or creates mandates for businesses and residents that are onerous, administratively burdensome, and not required of their competitors in neighboring communities. The increased cost to businesses to comply ultimately get passed on to consumers through higher prices, making it difficult to compete with businesses in neighboring cities that don't have the same fixed costs. St. Louis Park is an interring suburb and has the distinction of being comfortably close to everything and easily accessible. And that same proximity allows consumers to easily shop outside of St. Louis Park. Implementing policy that is originally considered progressive can actually end up being regressive as consumers and businesses seek alternatives right over city borders. We favor efforts to continue to encourage recycling efforts through the utilization of programs already in place, like Minnesota WasteWise and Hennepin County's business recycling grants. TwinWest believes an approach to reducing plastics and polystyrene that is incentive-based, includes the stakeholders in the process, and takes business and consumer interests into consideration works the very best. Thank you for your time.
Thank you to members of the council and staff for the opportunity. Minnesota Restaurant Association was, as Daniel said, involved in Minneapolis, and we have been involved in the implementation, education, kind of preparation for the next phases, and we've learned a lot through that process. We have about 2,000 members in the Restaurant Association, about 700 lodging properties that also are interested in many of these issues. There are really four things that we are concerned about. One of them is cost. Simon did a great job of showing you the alternatives, and if he was showing you alternatives to bicycles, he started with a Mercedes. But GOS is a wonderful product. It is the pulpy residue from pressing sugarcane. It is made in a number of places around the world, but it is a premium product. It is a very light in weight. It is does not absorb very much. It doesn't have a lot of insulating capacity, but it's a wonderful product. It is dramatically more expensive than, and I'm not aware of many, if any, of our members that are using bagasse, at least in great quantities. There are a couple of boutique places that use it. More common are pressed paper, made by a number of manufacturers, including Dart and others. It is quite a bit heavier. It is still dramatically more expensive. the big message about what you're proposing to do is that you will help the environment and add cost for your constituents. Is it it somewhat disappears with increased cost in food commodities and labor, but cost is an issue. Many of the restaurants in St. Louis Park are franchised restaurants. They currently buy packaging that's standard on a national basis through national contracts. If they are required because of changes you make, particularly in the area of rigid polystyrene, if they have to have a different container, Dairy Queen uses a rigid polystyrene treat cup for peanut buster parfaits and caramel nut goodies and all the other stuff they make. They order them by the tens of millions in rigid PS. If they have to do a custom cup for the handful of Dairy Queen outlets in Minneapolis or here, Minneapolis has actually granted a exception for the treat cup from Dairy Queen. But we go from them buying as part of a 6,500 restaurant cooperative that buys in common to asking 10 or a dozen or 15 restaurants to buy a non-standard product in relatively small quantities. There's also a six-month waiting period to get non-standard products approved by the franchisee. This is true of other kinds of cups, but rigid, we've had a lot less challenge, very honestly, replacing polystyrene foam than we have rigid polystyrene. The little souffle cups that have sauce from your neighborhood Chinese restaurant or Thai restaurant or barbecue sauce are probably rigid PS. There are, as Simon mentioned, PLA replacements. They're a fair amount more expensive. There may be PE or PETE replacements. They're softer and not quite as dependable on keeping the lids on, which gets back to the discussion we had a month ago about why we think plastic bags are better for food than paper bags because of saucy foods. But cost is clearly an issue. Now, I do want to differ with Simon on the issue of lined cups. McDonald's tested PLA lined cups in Chicago because they're sort of required at O'Hare. Subway has tested them from Huhtamäki in Finland and a number of places around the country, and they are fine for a while. But if cold beverages, particularly carbonated beverages, sit in a PLA cup for a period of time, like in a cart at an airport or in a baby carriage if someone's walking around a lake, they do tend to have more of a problem with dripping and filtering than PE line cups. We think PE line cups are probably the long term. They're much less expensive. They're very dependable. Guests like them. Same thing with lids. PLA lids are fairly dramatically more expensive. Now, it is interesting. One of the companies that Simon represents also has a PS lid that says on the top of the lid, PS, polystyrene, 25% post-consumer content. So somebody, someplace, is recycling rigid polystyrene. Now, I think it would be really cool if there's a little competition here that Minneapolis did something really cool. You would go one step further if you were the leaders in the Midwest in recycling both rigid or foam polystyrene. And I think the industry is serious about being willing to help you with that. And I know our members are concerned about, we do everything humanly possible to reduce litter, but litter doesn't change much if it's compressed paper or if it is PS foam, except that the compressed paper costs more and takes a little more room to store, adds a little more to the cost of service. I do want to commend Minneapolis for the process. Having 9 months to a year between the time we have firm rules and the time they're effective was quite helpful. Also, giving staff the authority without having to bring things back to you, but with guidance as to what it is you want them to do. In Minneapolis, it was if something cost significantly more, and I think we use 10 or 15%, Daniel, than the, and that's the compostable lids in part are that we don't have curbside compost universally, but it's also a fairly significant cost difference. And so that process has worked well. And then the education process is also helpful. I am concerned if the city has to set up a separate enforcement mechanism that has costs, where do those dollars come from? And I know that my members are very sensitive about increased fees. We pay fairly significant fees to Hennepin County for restaurant inspections today. And if making this work required an additional fee, that would be a challenge. Because as Deb said, it is not reasonable that someone would want to pay more for a fill in the blanks, a peanut butter parfait in St. Louis Park than they could buy the same product for in Hopkins or anyplace else. And so our concerns are cost, the availability of exceptions, particularly for PE-lined cups and lids, the time to enforce, and the availability of exceptions.
Tim?
All right. Mr. Wilkin.
Thank you very much. Once again, I'm Tim Wilkin with the Minnesota Beverage Association. We're the makers and distributors of just about every non-alcoholic beverage that you can think of.
Non-dairy, non-alcoholic.
Some of them, you'd be surprised when you walk through the facilities. There's some that have some dairy in there.
You're not the milkman.
I'm not the milkman.
Right.
The main thing that I want to convey to you today is just the difference between the polystyrene foam and the rigid polystyrene lids. That's my one little item that I need to talk about, because there's really no economical alternative to a PS lid. This is what we're talking about, what you get on the top of your fountain cup. Holds your straw and keeps it from spilling. When we went through the Minneapolis ordinance and the working group to talk about exemptions, this was exempted because, as Dan said, the standard was like 10 or 15% cost difference. The alternatives that are compostable were kind of off the charts. The survey that was done at that time showed that the cost difference for your local merchants, your restaurants, was 214% to 400%, somewhere in that range, depending on the size and the different cup lids. So that's really what I'm here to convey to you, that you don't take all polystyrene is the same. The lids, there's really no alternatives that are economical at all. So,
questions for our business participants from council? Councilman Helfen.
Thanks for the information, and it was funny when Salmon was speaking a minute ago or a while ago, I was trying to pull something up on the computer because he was talking about sports venues, and I happened to be out in Seattle for a National League of Cities meeting, not last year but the year before, and I got to tour both of their baseball facility and their football facility, and they were like the leaders in the alliance, and they made a point to, you know, say the Twins were on board and the Wild were on board. So I was going to kind of second what he was saying. And to that end, I'm getting to a question here. If they can do it at the sports venues on a mass basis, why can't business jump on board and say, look what the sports venues are doing? They're doing a great job. They're trying to be green. They're trying to be, compostable. Why can't the business community say, let's follow the lead of somebody that's being as green as they possibly can? It sounds like you guys are saying, it's all great, but it costs too much. Or that lid that you just showed me, there's no replacement for it. When I see I see Simon over there shaking his head as you're doing that. He seems to think that there is a replacement for that. So, I mean, we have some competing interests here.
Council member, there clearly is a replacement. The question is cost. Oh, and
But you didn't say that.
Yeah.
He said there is no replacement for this. He didn't say there is no replacement barring cost.
He said economical.
Okay. All right. Then I stand
now,
correct.
There is some difference between when you go to a Holiday Station store and you want to buy a 16-ounce unsweetened or sweetened beverage, whichever you prefer, and you'd like to pay 99 cents for it, or when you go to a Target Field and a 16-ounce soft drink is $6. You can do bagasse as a hot dog carrier when you're going to charge $6 for the hot dog. You can't do that if they're 2 for $3 at Holiday.
I also think, just because I have a little experience in this sporting
fire away
facility space, is to be clear that plastic lids in sporting arenas are traditional PS. So the Wild, the Twins, are using traditional PS lids. They have gone...
Not
more. The Wild is.
Well, I will say that when I was in Seattle,
yeah,
I went to the, we happened to be there when the Vikings were playing Seattle.
Ironically.
So we went to the game. Oh. And they.
Talk
they,
about waste.
Yeah, that was talk waste, about waste. Yeah.
Oh, no,
that
no,
was
no.
A, well, we had a good time. But that they were, you know.
Everything?
They were zero waste, you know, to the extent that they could be.
Okay.
And including their. They're top, so
okay.
If cost is not an object,
so you're,
then
it's more about cost, is what you're saying,
and competition, with the exception of the cup issue. The cup issue is both cost and long-term customer satisfaction.
Okay. Questions from council, Councilmember Brosson.
Yeah, I'd like to ask how many people here put a cover on their cup when they drink a cup of water at home. See, I don't necessarily buy into there's not a lower cost alternative. It's don't put a lid on it at all, because I don't think the average person is that in danger of spilling stuff, and I don't know that there's giant demand for it. But
Mr. McElroy,
my members in the quick service and fast casual business do between 50% and 75% of their business through the drive-through. Not having a lid in the drive-through is just not realistic, both for getting it from the fountain to the guest and the guest getting it from car to home or wherever they're taking it, car to office. It is more of a safety issue on the hot drink side. I've had this conversation with Starbucks and Caribou, and they worry about increased spilling of a fairly hot liquid if they don't provide a cup, or a lid rather. And they are very concerned about both the cost and Simon indicates the fit and finish has gotten better. There are PLA lids that will stay on, but there's still lots of national chains that find the PS lid is more secure than a PLA or PE lid. That may change over time. Cost is not likely to change a lot over time. And your constituents do care, at least in part, about the cost. And the opportunity I hope that you will consider and to take advantage of the industry's offer to look at some form of recycling for at least one of these PS forms.
Councilmember Ravdy.
Well, and that just sparks some thinking about, I mean, maybe the challenge back to the industry is to create a container and the shape of a container for coffee and other things that doesn't spill in the same way. We tend to be very narrow in our choices, and I would think that there are other ways to shape a container that would not require a top. And that might be a way to reduce as well.
Any other questions from council? Councilmember Spano.
Just out of curiosity, that lid versus something that's compostable, what is the cost difference?
I can't tell you exactly because I'd have to look through the spreadsheet that I had. That there was a survey that was done when Minneapolis was looking at theirs. The various sizes were between 214% more and 400% more.
But are we talking about 214% of 1/8 of a cent?
No.
Or are we talking 214% of 10 cents? I'm curious what that
get you
scale
current
is.
Data. I have a little trouble getting current data because large volume franchisees pay a lot less than people who
right.
buy one case at Restaurant Depot. But I will try to get you some prices and pass them on through Kayla. It is a significant difference. It is like, and Simon, where are you? Simon knows some of these numbers because you sell both. And the they're sold usually in cases of
1,000.
And we'll get you some prices. I'm not going to take them off the top of my head because I don't remember.
Okay, thank
but
you.
But they're in the order of magnitude that I think Tim
Simon.
Remembered.
Come on up. You're fine.
Whatever.
Deb's out.
I would just like to bring to the table that understand that cost is a relative thing. Restaurants incur cost increases on products from all their manufacturers on a regular basis. I sell plastic products. We get price increases from those major manufacturers every 3, 4, 5 months. It changes. The raw material that's used to make those products, mainly based on the oil side, they're going to have changes. Our compostable products, honestly, one of my manufacturers, I haven't seen a price increase in 2 years. Okay, I mean, I know I could pull up the last increase, and not to pick on Solo, but I mean, those are the ones I see a lot because we sell Solo plastics. So, I mean, I see, and they could speak to how often they have price increases. I really feel like I understand the equation of being able to go somewhere else for that product, but I really think that that cost needs to be something that the business needs to take care of. That's just the way it goes.
So, Simon, odds are in Minneapolis, you have a customer
yep.
who has made the conversion.
Or started their business by using compostables from the get-go.
Or made yep. the conversion because of new ordinances
sure.
that has had to take into account a different price from the previous lid to this lid at the same volume.
Absolutely.
Can you give us a hypothetical example of what that difference was?
Excuse me, we actually, staff has a spreadsheet
oh, okay.
with some numbers if we want to go there.
Kayla?
This was provided in council report on page 40. This is a comparison of an 8-ounce cup polystyrene lid, comparing it to an 8-ounce cup compostable lid. The difference in price stated in this spreadsheet is 392% increase.
And that's specifically a coffee cup lid, correct? That's what you're talking about, because I don't
does
know.
Not, it does not say a coffee cup lid. It's an 8-ounce cup polystyrene lid.
What is it compared to? Yeah. How many at what and how many at what?
And it's comparing be. Same unit price for an 8-ounce cup compostable lid.
And again, I question where the data is coming from. There's multiple manufacturers with plenty of you know, fighting back and forth for pricing, competition out there. I just don't think the numbers.
Kayla, who provided sure. this chart?
Well done.
This chart was provided to the Minnesota Beverage Association by the Plastics Food Packaging. I'm sorry, I'm botching your name.
So let's okay. look at, in comparison, you've got the case count is?
The case count is 1,000 units.
And that is price per case?
Price per case is $21.75 for a polystyrene 8-ounce cup lid. Compare that to a 1,000 case of the 8-ounce cup compostable lids, and that is $107.10.
So I think council
was
asking.
I wish I could sell
that. I'm sorry, but I think council was asking just what a percentage was in general, and back to what we'd said before, we can get some data on some more
yep.
numbers for you.
And,
if I could
go
note
ahead.
Too, I think the sources are helpful,
yeah.
and this is from the plastics industry, and that's great, but I'd like also to have comparison pricing sources and data from other perspectives as well to compare.
And please understand that, as Dan stated, I mean, volume is a major issue or major stipulation to what is charged to a customer.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, it looks like from these figures, the cost is 2 cents a lid for the PS lids versus 10 or 11 cents a lid. So that's what we're talking about, a dime.
Any other questions from council, business representatives? We will have times for general question and answering at the end as well. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce Kate Davenport from Eureka Recycling. Eureka is a zero-waste nonprofit that develops programs and partnerships for recycling and composting that balance cost, convenience, and environmental benefit. Joining Kate is Lynn Hoffman. Thank you.
How's that? There we go. Thank you very much for inviting us here to be part of this dialogue, and we really want to commend Council for considering action on this really important issue. We know you've heard a lot of information tonight, so we'll do our best to get through all the talking points we have. So Eureka Recycling, we're a nonprofit zero-waste organization based in Minneapolis. So our perspective is both as a recycler, we do the collection of residential recycling and business recycling, and we also operate a MRF, a material recovery facility. Dan? So we have that perspective from the kind of boots on the ground where the rubber meets the road, but the reason that we recycle is because we're a mission-driven, zero-waste organization. And we're not a zero waste organization just to save. Our mission isn't zero waste just to save landfill space. Our mission is zero waste because of the impacts that waste has on our health, human health, environmental health, and our economic health of our communities. And so for that reason, we strongly support the elimination of polystyrene packaging. And we'll run through a couple of the reasons why here tonight. So one of the first areas of concern, obviously, is that polystyrene is created from a product that's not renewable. In general, part of the problem with our consumption patterns as a society are that it's linear. We have a finite amount of resources, we're extracting, we're producing, we're using, and then we're ultimately destroying them at the end, which requires us to go back to get more. The source of material for polystyrene is a non-renewable source. 8% of worldwide oil is for feedstock for the production of plastics, including polystyrene. And a full third of that is used as packaging and other short-lived disposables. So what we want to say here is that there are important uses for plastic. There are life-saving uses. There are durable uses. It has a role, I think, in a responsible community. But if you think of all of the resources that it takes and the time and the money and effort it takes and the environmental impacts it has to just create that cup that one person uses for 5 minutes at the max, and then the long-term impacts that it has after that person is complete. It really helps you understand how to draw the circle of impact. When people talk about life cycle analysis, it's really important to look at how widely you're drawing that circle and what's included in the impacts that you're considering. We wanted to touch briefly on Minnesota wildlife. The coastal wildlife and ocean sea life has had a lot of really powerful and strong marketing. But what we're coming to understand is that the impact on water, marine life in our Great Lakes is equal, if not more, than the oceans. We're finding that microparticles are 24% higher in the Great Lakes than they are in the Atlantic Ocean, where you hear about the southern gyres and the garbage patches. There's high concentrations of plastics in the ocean, but we're finding even higher concentrations in our Great Lakes. You can't see it. It doesn't float around in big patches like it does in some of the oceans, but there, as has been talked about tonight, polystyrene doesn't biodegrade, it photodegrades. So slowly over time, it becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. And as it becomes those small particles, there are two problems. One is that when wildlife consumes it, can't process it, it really causes them to starve to death. So their systems get packed with the plastic and they die from starvation. So that's horrible. There's toxins in the plastic itself, but the real problem with these microparticles is they act like sponges in the water. They attract and accumulate other toxins that are in the water. And so they become really highly toxic, and they're consumed at the bottom of the food chain. And so those toxins then are accumulated further up the food chain, and that's how they eventually impact human health, which is, I believe, where we're headed next. So, in fact, the EPA has cited that 100% of humans, they're estimating, have styrene in our bodies, in our systems somewhere. It comes from food. Styrene is highly transferable through contact with food. In fact, there are some European countries that mandate styrene be listed as an ingredient if you're going to sell the food on a styrofoam tray or in styrofoam packaging because it leaches so much. It doesn't happen here. The FDA has a 5% by weight limit on styrene content in food, which is appalling, but partly why we don't hear about this kind of chemical content ending up in our food system. And there have been many studies that have linked styrene to carcinogens. There are, I think council member, is it Mavity, talked about the two main chemicals used in creating polystyrene that have been shown to be neurotoxins, studies that show that higher levels in the bloodstream of teenagers are linked to higher levels of type 2 diabetes, linked to higher blood pressure, different health impacts in that way. I'm trying to go fast because I know we're out of time.
You're fine.
We're okay? Okay. One thing I wanted to mention here, too, there's been a lot of conversation around the cost of alternative products and implementing alternatives and implementing bans. And something to consider is what the cost of all of the impacts of this product is and who's currently paying the costs for the use of polystyrene. And it is certainly true that in the marketplace, some of the alternatives right now for businesses would be an additional cost. But I think it's something to consider when you think about where that might be countered in the rest of the community in terms of environmental impacts and health impacts and other economic costs that are a little more hidden.
Thanks, Council. So I'm going to talk about the recyclability issue and that we do run a MRF here in the Twin Cities and deal with polystyrene, both the rigid polystyrene and styrofoam on a daily basis. And I just want to cite, first off, this issue of markets. That word, that kind of phrase and that discussion gets thrown out a lot. Are there markets? Aren't there markets, et cetera? You know, DART and others will say, yes, there are markets. And for us as a MRF, it's really important that there are consistent markets. So if there's one market that pops up somewhere, how long has that been around for? Is it going to be around in 6 months? So we tend to use a general rule of, are there three markets and have they been around for more than 3 years? And obviously there's a chicken and egg there, but we have encountered many situations where we start to look at adding a product and there is one market somewhere and that market goes out of business and then that market no longer exists. And now we've educated people to put something in the recycling bin, and to reverse that is extremely difficult. And so we have not found consistent, reliable markets for polystyrene or styrofoam. And I think some of the recent studies and work that you saw come out of New York City address this. We won't get into all of that detail. I don't think we have time. But from a MRF perspective and a recycler's perspective, it has to be consistent. It can't be a pilot. It can't be a market that has been supported by the industry, but what happens when that support from the industry disappears in 3 years, which we've seen that dynamic happen before. On the markets issue, I think that's one side of it. I think in terms of the impact that we've seen in our own MRF, styrene breaks apart really easily. Styrofoam, as well as the rigid packaging, if you feel it, you can tell it's kind of brittle, and it breaks apart really easily. The industry sometimes addresses this by talking about densifiers, and that's one way to, if you can collect the material, to kind of densify it down in order to be able to sell it to market. But the other issue is before you can even get to densifying it, it breaks apart and contaminates other material. So I think that's actually one of the biggest issues that we face as a MRF and other MRFs face is the contamination of other materials. And you know, if you go to paper mills, we sell paper to the Rockton, now West Rock Mill in St. Paul, and you actually walk through their mill, you see little styrofoam beads that go through that whole process because the styrofoam breaks apart and goes into the paper. And this is an issue that probably doesn't get talked about a whole lot, but it's basically we're burying contamination in the bales of other material that are getting recycled, and that has a huge impact further down the line in terms of the recyclability of the material. The paper industry could talk about this a lot, actually. I think, yes, you can recycle it technically. Maybe we could find markets. Maybe we could densify it. But the nature of recycling today, which is to put everything in one bin, compact it, and take it to a MRF, that material in that process breaks apart and goes into other materials. And that affects the not only recycling that material, but it affects the recyclability of other materials. And so I think you can't just look at this in terms of the impact of polystyrene and recycling. And I appreciate what the PCA is saying about weight, but if that material is impacting all of the other materials, that has an impact on recycling beyond the 2% or 4% that polystyrene is. I would encourage you guys to ask questions of the MRF that you guys use in St. Louis Park as well about this issue, but you can literally see polystyrene popping up in all parts of the MRF. So in terms of addressing polystyrene, and I think one council person asked this issue, there are about over 87 communities, those being counties and cities across the country, that have implemented effective bans from Florida to Maine to California. It is not just Northern California that has implemented polystyrene bans. And we really firmly believe that you can build, that this is an exciting opportunity for St. Louis Park to build on the momentum created for Minneapolis. You're talking about kind of the impact across borders and the cost impacts. I think St. Louis Park has an opportunity here to join with Minneapolis, start to create some of those economies of scale in terms of cost to restaurant, and create some of the maybe economies of scale in terms of educating people. Your composting program that you're growing is a great complement to this. So we would say that, you know, this is a complement to some of the other work that you do that I think expands upon getting to zero waste, but also addressing human health issues and environmental issues. And, you know, in terms of effectively doing this, working with stakeholders, working with restaurants, working with suppliers like Litin, working with your recycling facilities, working with haulers is the way to make this effective. And I think Minneapolis has some good lessons learned, some successes and some challenges that they know from that. And then I think lastly, or a couple other things we'd like to end on, is that, you know, we work with about 70 restaurants in the Twin Cities that have implemented composting. They have, on average, at least a 90% composting and recycling rate. And when we got to the issue with a lot of these partners about what do they do about takeout packaging, you know, it wasn't about how do we find the exact alternative to this, but they went higher up and said, when do we really need takeout packaging? Or when do we really need this kind of packaging? And really rethinking the way that they do things. And yes, you can make the argument that they're boutiques. But one of the really interesting things that we've found is we started with 5 restaurants in 2008. We do hardly any marketing. And those restaurants themselves have started promoting to other restaurants. And you're starting to see a snowball effect. And I think the same thing comes up with polystyrene. They're really creative, interesting ways to deal with this. And I think restaurants have already begun to show how to address that. And we just need to support that to continue that work. I also, you know, I think at Eureka we would like to challenge the concept that this material gets turned into energy and therefore that's a beneficial use. Most of our trash in Hennepin County goes to the incinerator, and there are challenges with that. And if you think about it, if styrene has all of the health impacts that we're talking about, burning that and putting it into our air is maybe not the best thing that we want to do, nor the most environmental solution to dealing with styrene. Sure. I think overall we really support the efforts that you guys are doing. I think there are tons of resources, including us, to help in the implementation of it. To hammer in on what Lynn said, we can talk about the cost of a lid all we want, but what is the cost of the styrene that's ending up in our bodies and in our food chains, and who's bearing that cost? And that's also a cost that your constituents hold, not just the cost of the cup on their soda from the restaurant. And I think it's important to look at all the costs and think about that whole circle. Is there anything you want to add?
Okay. Questions from council for Eureka. Councilmember Mavity.
I always have a question, don't I? No, this is really helpful. One of the questions, and frankly, I'm not sure it's for you or if it's for our EPA folks, but you mentioned about the burning at the HERC, which is where a lot of our garbage and certainly the Twin Cities garbage goes to be incinerated, and that this concentrate some of the carcinogens and neurotoxins that come out of some of these materials. My understanding is that we have very little information about measuring what's actually coming out of the HERC, that we have been working with the Minnesota EPA? What
MPCA?
Thank you, the MPCA, who's supposed to be measuring that, but we don't have great knowledge. And so I don't know if the question is, how do we know about what we're contributing in terms of polystyrene and other things? And or what do we know about what's getting airborne out? Sure. Either way would be informative.
We have
again, we can, oh.
Go ahead.
Well, we can't speak directly to, again, we have limited information about HERC itself. There are reports about, you know, the, I think I recently read about 57 chemicals in different compounds are released when polystyrene is burned. You know, there are various scrubbers or various processes in incineration. So I don't know exactly what's coming out of HERC to your question, but we do know that there's an impact. And then the other piece of it, of course, is that these are, whether or not it creates a little bit of energy, it creates a lot of health impacts along the way, and then those materials are destroyed, and we need to go back for more. So again, it's that linear consumption piece that's...
We still have time. Just hang on one sec. We still have time for general questions at the end, so let's make these questions really to Eureka, just to keep us on...
Sure. But just to add to that, I think the other important thing to remember about waste to energy is, yes, it produces energy. It still creates a toxic ash waste that's 30% of the weight that comes in mm-hmm. that has to be landfilled. So you've burned stuff, you've created energy, but it's still a third of it has to be landfilled, and now it's concentrated in a highly toxic ash. And so, you know, from our perspective, that doesn't warrant the energy that you're producing through the process, not to mention the loss of the resources.
Just to finish up, this is, sorry if I took us off a little. I wonder if we can formally request to Hennepin County to get a report on the waste from the HERC that goes airborne, and whatever their latest information is, hopefully it's in the last year or two. I doubt that it is, but it would be helpful if it was to get a report on that, if we could formally request that of Hennepin County.
And by waste airborne, are you speaking of emissions
from
HERC?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Councilmember Lindbergh.
Just one quick follow-up for staff. I think it would be helpful, perhaps even going a step further, for us to have a conversation with someone from the Recovery Center from Hennepin County, if that's possible as part of this conversation or a broader discussion.
I think that would be fabulous.
Okay. Can I just say one more piece that questions came before we could answer this, but what also when you guys are thinking about recycling, I would encourage you to ask the question of what it's getting recycled into. So even in the case where it can get recycled, what is it getting recycled into? And we talk a lot at Eureka about highest and best use. So recycling something into a picture frame most likely means that picture frame is going to end up in the landfill. So you've extended the life of it, but but have you really created a closed loop as opposed to a piece of paper that's going back into a piece of paper or PET that's going back into PET? So I just encourage you to dig into those terms, recyclable versus not recyclable, and really think about, why are we recycling? What is the impact we're trying to have from that? We're trying to decrease the amount of resources that we're using and decrease the environmental and health impact. So it's recycling is not the end goal. The recycling is the means to the impact that we want to get. And I just encourage you to ask those questions when you're considering this.
If I could have a follow-up.
I'll
be more on target this time. If you could go back a slide or two that goes to the human impacts. Oh, yes. It would be helpful. And go to the next page, if you would. I don't know if that's still the human impacts. Well, in any case, I'm looking, yes. One is, if you could cite both the study in New York for the record later and maybe just give a little bit of those highlights. You sort of teased us, but I'm not sure that I got the headlines on what that is about. And then, in addition, I had asked earlier about a question about the lakes mm-hmm. here in Minnesota, so that's helpful. I'm not sure I saw a source for that information, and that would be helpful either now or later to get a source.
It is cited in the report that we provided staff.
Perfect.
So I think the link should be there for you, but we can follow up if it's not.
Thank you. Sure. Perfect. Mm-hmm. And then the New York study?
That's also should be in the report if it's not there.
Just headlines.
Yeah.
For us.
Or here. No, there's more, some more. So did you want a little bit more detail now?
Yes.
About
yeah. I mean, just, mm-hmm. yes, just the general.
Mm-hmm. Oh, of what happened. So about a year ago, New York City sanitation looked at whether to, or New York City looked at whether to ban polystyrene or not. They did a one-year pilot study on collecting and recycling, and at the end of that pilot study decided to go ahead and ban it. And so they did work with industry, and at the end of that decided it wasn't going to work. And yeah, we can give you the study from the city and the NRDC about why they made that decision to go ahead and ban it.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Eureka from Council? Okay. Now we'll move into just general Q&A from council to presenters or from presenters to council.
Well, now can I follow up with the MPCA with my question? I'm not sure if Mrs. Or Ms.
Cioci
has any additional information about the emissions out of the HERC.
Okay. On the HERC, so I don't have that at my fingertips, but I've written it down as a request to take back to work.
Thank you.
Other questions, Mr. Levy?
Yeah, I was just going to comment on that.
You
one.
Need a Can microphone.
You need to go to a mic. Sorry.
I mean, if you're going
to
say I don't know anything, you don't need a mic.
On the HERC question, the Energy Recovery Council, which represents all the operators, including Covanta, has studies there what EPA conducted on the emissions on all of these facilities, electrostatic precipitators, how much comes out. But I would encourage you, obviously, to contact the Covanta HERC people, to get at that. And I had one question on styrene. Could I?
Sure.
There was a lot of information, I know, put up there on styrene. I would ask you to look at all the science studies that we're submitting on that, because number one, styrene is a naturally occurring material. It's in strawberries, it's in cinnamon, and it's in there in higher concentrations. Certainly it's in your body because we eat that. But as far as what you saw, some of the information that was presented up there on styrene exposure and that type of thing, the science basically would tell you that there's just not enough on it. And then finally, if you'd like, on New York City is very interesting. New York City, as Kate had mentioned, a year and a half ago, or a couple years ago, took a look at polystyrene food service and foam. And the issue in New York City was all about recycling. And the recycling coordinator there said that you can't recycle foam here in the United States, not enough markets. They challenged the industry in all of 2014 to come up with a plan that would show that you can do it in a manner that, fit in with the city, that it would be safe, and that there would be markets. And that plan was submitted, and the plan basically showed they can go from landfilling at a cost of $80 per ton to guaranteeing markets at $160 a ton, but not only recycling foam food service, but all polystyrene foam. And the sanitation department decided that because there was one major recycler in Minneapolis who guaranteed to take all the material, that one market, and NRDC put on a lot of pressure, saying, well, one market's not enough. But the bottom line is New York City missed an opportunity not only to recycle food service, but entire foam recycling, and that would have reduced everything that's going to landfill right now. So when we say that, we can work with the MRFs and everything, Kate brought up a lot of good points, I think, and there's some new MRF studies out there that get exactly at what she's talking about, breaking up in little pieces, how you deal with that ahead of time, so that, again, the industry is there.
Any other questions?
I'll just respond that with all due respect to the fact that styrene is in strawberries, we learned about 35 years ago that cows emit methane and trees emit carbon dioxide, and that doesn't relieve us of the responsibility to still reduce those sources from other places.
No, good point.
Any other questions? Well, I'd like to thank everyone for participating today. Just to remind the public and everyone here, this is the first step in the process of the City of St. Louis Park. The next step is a study session on August 10th. There will be a public information process with stakeholders from August through September. Public comment will begin in late September, proposed policy recommendations in late October, and final study session discussions and finalized policy decisions, if any, would happen in December of 2015. Mayor Pro Tem?
Oh, thank you. On behalf of the City Council and the City staff, I'd also like to thank all of the panelists for their participation in tonight's discussion, as well as those of you who've returned again and provided us with information during our discussion, both on this and plastic bags last month. Special thanks to our moderator, Blois, Olson, for facilitating the discussion this evening as well. We'd also like to acknowledge those of you in the audience who have attended, and those of you watching at home, to learn more about the issues along with the council. And thanks for taking the time to be here or to watch. As Blois pointed out, council will be directing staff to prepare a communications plan to provide information to the public about the process to consider policy options for polystyrene containers. Public listening sessions are going to be held separately for both the polystyrene containers and plastic bags, and those dates will be advertised as soon as they are available. Any interested person at all, including residents and businesses, as well as the city's Environment and Sustainability Commission, will be invited to provide comment during these public listening sessions. So I'd encourage those of you at home, residents here, please contact your city council or the staff and let us know what you think about these issues. Again, we appreciate the excellent discussion tonight and the dedication of all those involved in the conversation, and thank you all for participating.